Hi, it's Paul Anderson, and this is Life Science Core Idea 1A. It's on structure and function. In other words, in nature, how does the form that an organism have fit its function? And so when we're talking about structure and function, it's important that your students understand the difference between the two. Structure is the physical appearance that you have. And so for example, in this wrench, it has a number of different structures. And so it's got this long arm. It's got this adjustable spanner, so I can spin this on this side, and then this spanner is going to move on that side. These are all structures. It's made of metal. It's very hard. These are all structures that this wrench has, but it doesn't speak to their function. Function is going to be what it does. And so when I spin this dial, the adjustable spanner is going to change in this direction. I also can move it up and down, so I have a huge amount of leverage. Now we're talking about function. And so in sciences, we call these two things, structure and function, anatomy and physiology. Anatomy is what it is, and physiology is what it does. But it's important that we work our students through a nice progression. And so where should we start in the lower elementaries? We should start by talking about structure and function. And so we can show them different structures and they can come up with the functions. And so if you're to look through these pictures over here, what do they do? Well, these are all eyes, and so they'd be responsible for vision, or your hand is for grasping. These are feathers, so they allow us to fly if we're a bird, but also provide insulation. These are the needles on a pine tree, so those are gonna give us food. In other words, do photosynthesis in plants, or these spines are defensive, or flowers are reproductive. And so students should get this understanding in the lower grades that the structure that organisms have fit the job that they do. But don't just set yourselves with animals. We should always be talking about plants. And so what are some plant structures here? Some things that jump out right away would be the roots and the stems and the leaves. And then the students should start to understand that each of these have function. The roots, remember, are going to bring in water, and that nutrients will move up through the stems. And then the leaves are going to be a site of, you know, food productions, where we're actually doing photosynthesis. We're converting gases into actual sugars. And so an understanding of structure and function is important, but as you move through the elementary levels, we want to talk about these four ideas, that these structures and functions, these structures that organisms have fit these big functions, growth, behavior, survival, and reproduction. So growth means we can get bigger or larger over time. Behavior is how we respond to our environment. Survival is, can we survive? Do we die or not? And then reproduction, can we pass our genes on to the next generation? And so we could point at a number of different structures in this cat that allow it to grow, behave, survive. So for example, its eyes allow it to gain information on its environment and can respond to that using its muscles and its bones. And so now I'm talking about internal structures. And so in elementary, we should be talking about structures on the inside and the outside of organisms that allow them to do these big four things. But we should keep it at the macro level. We shouldn't be talking about cells yet. That's going to come when we get to the level of middle school. And so as we move into middle school, students should understand that life is made up of cells. All life is made of cells. Not all life is multicellular. In other words, this trout right here is made up of billions of cells, and this paramecium is made up of just one cell. And so no matter what, if we find life, make sure your students know that life is built of cells. And those cells have to allow that organism to respond to their environment. In other words, they need to respond to the flow of the water if you're a trout, or changes in the concentration of salt if you're a paramecium, or finding food. So they need to be able to find food, they need to be able to get water, and they also need to dispose of waste. So all organisms have to do that, and they use their cells to do it. Now, it's going to be at the level of a single cell. So a paramecium, for example, is going to pump out extra water that comes in through a contractile vacuole. In a trout, they're going to have to get rid of a lot of that excess water through urine that's really dilute. And so they have solutions to all of these problems, but they're solutions at the level of a cell. They should also understand a little bit of the cell structure. And so don't beat them to death with all memorizing all the parts of a cell, but there's some major parts of a cell that they should really understand. So the cell membrane, for example, is going to be around the inside of every cell, and it regulates what goes in and out of a cell. You could talk about the different types of cells. This would be a prokaryotic or a bacterial cell, and this would be a eukaryotic cell. But there are some other structures in here. So the DNA would be an important one that I'll talk about in just a second. But don't just memorize everything. Make sure you're choosing some wise functions and structures. Know how life is organized. And so every life form is made up of cells. And if they're multicellular, those cells are organized into tissues. The tissues make up organs, and then the organs eventually make organisms. And so students should have an understanding of this level of organization within an organism. As we move into high school, we want to get into more of the biochemistry of cells and structures within cells. So for example, the importance of water. What does water provide? Well, it provides an aqueous environment for all these cool chemical reactions to go on in a cell. And so all life requires water. There are four major macromolecules that cells require or life requires. Those are proteins, carbohydrates, lipids, nucleic acids. Students should understand those four and what role they play. Proteins pretty much build everything. So when you're looking at me, you're looking at proteins and the actions of proteins. Carbohydrates and lipids are going to provide energy or food to organisms and at the cellular level as well. Carbohydrates can give us big structure like cellulose in a plant, but lipids also give us structure. So the membranes, all the membranes in a cell are going to be made up of lipids, and then nucleic acids are going to be the DNA and the RNA, and they're responsible for information inside cells. And so let's go in a little bit deeper on that. The DNA in a eukaryotic cell is going to be found in the nucleus. And that DNA is going to contain sections of it, which are genes. So genes are bits of DNA that code for a specific protein. And so there's basically information within the nucleus, that is information in the form of DNA. That information is transmitted out into the cytoplasm by RNA, but basically we're going to translate those genes into proteins because proteins make up the cell. And so changes in the DNA result in changes in the proteins. We also should emphasize the importance of feedback loops. So how to maintain an internal environment as your environment changes, you do that through feedback loops. And there are two feedback loops that we use. Positive feedback loops if we want to move away from a set point. And so for example, on this tree, all the fruit are going to go ripe at the same exact time. And we do that using a positive feedback loop. Basically, one of the fruits will give off a chemical called ethylene that'll diffuse other fruits are going to pick that up, and now they're going to give off this gas as well. And so if we want everything to occur all at once, that's going to be a positive feedback loop. So for example, when your body starts to be invaded by bacteria during an infection, we're going to have a positive feedback loop that's going to bring white blood cells to that area. We also have important negative feedback loops. That's when we want to keep our environment around a set point. And so the internal temperature of most humans is around 37 degrees Celsius. And so how do we maintain that? Well, as our body temperature starts to drop, we're going to do things like shiver. We're going to start to vasoconstrict. So we're going to keep our capillaries constricted so blood doesn't lose heat to the environment. And that's going to warm us up. What happens if we get too warm? We're going to sweat. We're going to vasodilate. And we're going to let some of that heat go. And so we're using feedback loops to maintain that environment. And so the structures inside organisms fit their function, what they do, and I hope that was helpful.